Retro Nerd.
Hello there. This is James Arnold Taylor, the voice of Obi-Wan Kenobi, and whenever I'm in this part of the galaxy, I listen to Dennis and Jay on podcast Stardust. Makes flying a little more tolerable. Don't tell Anakin.
This is podcast Stardust.
This station is now the ultimate power in the universe.
With Dennis Keithley and Jay Krebs.
Your behavior is continually unexpected.
The galaxy source for Star Wars news, reviews, and discussion.
Now witness the firepower of this fully armed and operational battle station.
Welcome back to Podcast Stardust. This is the fully armed and operational podcast dedicated to Star Wars news, reviews, and discussion. I'm Dennis Keithley.
And I'm Jay Krebs.
And in this episode, we'll be covering more news that came out of Celebration. But before we get into all that, Jay, can you remind everybody where we can be found around the internet?
My pleasure as always, Dennis. We are on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram at Podcast Stardust.
All right. The dish is aligned. The signal is boosted to maximum output. The shield is down. And we're now broadcasting to the galaxy. So in our last news episode, we went through all of the announcements for Disney Plus that came out of Celebration and then the week and a half since then. And in this episode, we're going to talk about everything else. So some books, some comics, a little bit of video game news, some Galaxy's Edge stuff as well. So there's a lot to get into. So let's get started. First up, we got some details from the High Republic panel. I'm going to fess up right now, Jay, and say I haven't watched that entire panel. My understanding is it's available online, but I just haven't found a spare hour since we got back from Anaheim in order to get that done. And I'm going to go back and watch it, but there are a lot of highlights that you can find from that panel online. Have you had a chance to dive into the details from the cast that was there at Celebration Anaheim?
No, like you, that's one of the things that I definitely have on my to-do list, my watch list right now. And I did catch a lot of things from Star Wars Celebration that were reposted, but this was not one of them, unfortunately.
Okay. Well, unfortunately, we're just not going to get into everything that they said. I mean, they talked, from the bits I've seen, they talked a lot about stuff that happened in Phase 1, and then they started teasing us with stuff that's happening in Phase 2. And just as a reminder, Phase 2 is considered the Age of Exploration. That was something that they talked a bit about at this panel. And it occurs 150 years prior to the events of Phase 1. And I believe it was Claudia Gray that was explaining that the tech of this time period isn't as advanced as what we're used to in Star Wars. And communications are something like the Pony Express, but with droids. Which
That's
is
funny.
Yeah, a kind of a fascinating concept to me, because we are used to instant communication across the galaxy. And you know, Starlight Beacon was a big part of that in Phase 1. So this idea that things could be happening in one area of the galaxy and an unexplored, unknown area of the galaxy, and then be completely unknown and unthought of or unheard of in another area is a new concept for Star Wars.
It really is. And not only that, but it's weird to kind of wrap your head around it, because even with the Old Republic things that we've gotten, you know, and my mind just immediately goes to the Darth Bane trilogy, it seemed like communications weren't all that bad even back then. So, I mean, and I know that that's not considered canon, but for it to be so rustic and so primitive during this time is kind of a surprise, I'm not gonna lie.
Yeah, and in some ways it's kind of like a extended version of the development of technology that we have in our own world, where you think back in the 50s and 60s, there were rotary phones everywhere, and to make a phone call was doing something long distance and it was expensive, whereas we all just now pick out our mobile phones and there is no charge for long distance. We all have unlimited plans for the most part. We don't have to worry about those type of minutes. And so communication is even much more instantaneous with the way we do text messages and emails and stuff like that, as opposed to this type of relay system that they're talking about. I mean, it's even more archaic, as you're suggesting with that word rustic, which I really like. You know, when you say Pony Express, you know, one half of our country was communicating with the other half of the country in a system that could take weeks.
Right.
So I'm just really curious what the story implications are going to be there and how careful they're going to be with paying attention to all that and how that's going to play out.
Mm-hmm.
Well, we did get the announcement of some of the books that I guess will be coming in wave two of phase two, starting with Cataclysm, which is being written by Lydia Kang. That'll be the adult novel. Quest for Planet X by Tessa Grattan, which will be the middle grade novel. And Path of Vengeance by Kevin Scott, which will be the young adult novel. Okay, I have two thoughts on this. First off, we know very little about these books. I'll say this. Of the three, I'm most excited about Path of Vengeance simply because it's by Kevin Scott, and I'm very familiar with his work in phase one of the High Republic, and he's done some incredible stories. Quest for Planet X sounds like something George Lucas almost would have written in that way he emulated those serials from the 30s and 40s with that. And that just sounds like such a title for that. But what do you think of the new book announcements?
Oh, well, it's funny because when I saw the title for Cataclysm, I thought it said Catechism. And I was like, wait, are they Catholic? No. but yeah, I think this is going to be an interesting addition to our library for sure. And I'm right with you. Kevin Scott has really brought his A game when it comes to all of the novels and the comics and everything. So that one, of course, just because of his name being on it, is first and foremost for me as well.
Yeah, and I'll have to double check on this, but it looks like the books that are coming out in wave one of phase two may have been pushed back a little bit, or it may have been just some of them, but I know they were originally coming out in October, but I've been starting to get notifications from Amazon that release dates have changed and it's like November 15th. And I don't know if that's just because they're following the same pattern where the adult novel and the middle grade novel come out 1 month before the young adult novel. And so they're spacing them out. But anyways, if you've pre-ordered these, you may want to go back and check and see what the date is that they're expected to be delivered at this point.
Mm-hmm.
This next bit I'm really pretty excited about. We are getting another audio drama set in the High Republic. This time it's being written by George Mann, and it's called The Battle of Jedha, and that's coming out in January 2023. I've loved all the audio dramas that they've done recently, whether it's been Dooku Jedi Lost, the Dr. Aphra one, Tempest Runner, and now we're getting another one set in the High Republic era. You know, first shot for George Mann doing this, but sign me up. These have all been a lot of fun.
Oh yeah, you had me at Jedha. But no, seriously, I mean, you're right. The audio dramas have been outstanding. So bring it on for sure. This is exciting.
Indeed. And then in some of the comic news, we got a cover for Charles Soule's project, The Blade of Bardotta, which is about Porter Engel, who we met as a senior Jedi who was kind of in semi-retirement, regarded as one of the best swordsmen in the Jedi Order. But this is his backstory. Charles Soule has described it as the most epic thing I have ever written, and it will explain the origins of the Barash Vow. So again, more things to be excited about. I mean, I thought Porter was awesome in phase one, and now we're going to get a chance to see him in a little bit more of his prime. And that should be a lot of fun.
Oh yeah, this I am so stoked for, because we've talked about how much we just loved Porter Engel, and just to hear Charles Soule say those words, the most epic thing I have ever written, that says a lot, because this man has had some amazing, astounding, spectacular pieces of literature out there. And so, wow, yeah, that's saying a lot. And I love this cover too, with Porter on the front, and he's almost got this very sinister look to his eyes, and his blade just looks amazing with the little cross. What's that thing called? Cross guard, like the off to the one side. But I think it's really cool the way that the light extends into the cross guard. And then he almost has like a half balaclava over his mouth, sort of a thing. And I'm just so excited for this one.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Charles Soule needs more work in the High Republic. I loved Light of the Jedi. I think it's still my favorite of the novels that came out so far. And he's been doing kind of these smaller projects. Now, he's also writing the main Star Wars title, so that's going to keep him busy. And he has his own novels that he writes in his other own independently owned comics that he writes. So I could see where his time might be a little spare
sparse in the ability to write another Star Wars novel. I hope he writes another one. You know, the two-parter that he did about Marcion Roe was simply fantastic. Mm-hmm. So, I give me more content from Charles Soule in the High Republic. That's all I'm going to say about that.
Amen.
I feel like you and I spoke this Nyx announcement into existence. Yes. We've been asking for a visual guide for the High Republic for some time. Well, we're not exactly getting that, but we are getting the art of the High Republic, and it's being written by Kristen Baver with a foreword by Kathleen Kennedy. But finally, it's great to have the comics and stuff like that that give us a glimpse at some of these characters. But there's a lot of things that I would love just to have a resource guide for. And I'm really hoping this Art of book is going to be that.
Oh, me too. And I am so grateful for just the idea of this right now. Mm-hmm. And like you said, because the comics, they do a good job, but it's just not the same as having a visual guide. So I'm super, super stoked about this.
I feel like every time we talked about novels, we asked for this. And so,
yes.
I like to think someone was listening and they went ahead and put this project into work. But I also know that they just had volumes of concept art. So why not turn it into something? Yeah, so
oh, for sure.
Cannot wait to get that.
Mm-hmm.
All right. Well, let's talk a bit more about Star Wars comics. We've got the announcement that we are getting a 10-issue limited series called Star Wars Yoda coming from Marvel. It will be set during The Empire Strikes Back, and the framing device is that Yoda is preparing for Luke's arrival, and he's reflecting on his life and his regrets. And this 10-issue series is going to have three story arcs in it. So the first one will be written by Calvin Scott with art by Nico Leon, and they will also be doing issue 10. And this Calvin Scott, we of course know from the High Republic comics. We were just talking about him and how prolific he was there. And he also wrote The Rising Storm. So this story is going to be set between phase one and phase two of the High Republic. So that's intriguing, Jay, because mm-hmm. this is something that you and I have also talked about in the past, where we don't know exactly what happens to the High Republic once they get done with phase three. We know there's three phases that they're talking right now, but if they're going to put stories in between the phases already, I don't know why they can't keep doing that in the future and give us more and more High Republic content that they don't necessarily have to end it after the 4 or 5 years that it's going to take to tell this master story that they have in mind.
Mm-hmm, I agree. And we really honestly haven't gotten a whole lot of Yoda even in the High Republic. So I think that this is a really great addition to the storytelling. And I'm glad that they're exploring this.
Right. He's primarily shown up in the High Republic Adventures that came out from IDW mm-hmm. and will now be coming out from Dark Horse. And then he was in that virtual reality game on the Oculus as one of the missions from Tales from Galaxy's Edge.
Uh-huh.
And so that's been his involvement. We have heard them say that kind of the issue with Yoda is that when he's there, he takes over a scene. Everyone wants to see what Yoda's going to do and say. And so they've been using him a bit more sparingly for that reason, which I get, but he was there. I'd like to have some of his adventures. I wouldn't be bothered sure. by that if he takes things over. So,
mm-hmm.
The second arc is going to be written by Jody Hauser and Luke Ross. So that'll be issues 4 through 6. And that will take place a few decades before the prequels. Jody Hauser has previously written the treatments for Rogue One, Thrawn, and some issues of Age of the Republic for Marvel as well. And then Mark Guggenheim and Alessandro Miracolo will be working on issues 7 through 9. And I am not clear exactly what their story is going to be about, but I'm assuming it will be progressing forward into the future, so likely somewhere during the prequels would be my guess.
Mm-hmm.
Any of these that you're particularly excited for?
Honestly, I like the idea of all of them more than I originally would admit, because as much as I love Yoda, it's kind of like, okay, love Yoda, but I want other stories. But mm-hmm. these two, honestly, really intrigue me. And I think the one that's going to be set during The Empire Strikes Back, honestly, is probably the most intriguing for me as he reflects on his life and his regrets, because that to me is something that I've always wondered, mm-hmm. you know, what the heck was going on. And even now there's some memes out there about Yoda sleeping away on Dagobah while, you know, all this stuff is happening out in the galaxy with Obi-Wan and Anakin and Vader and, you know, Luke and Leia and everything like that. But honestly, I think he was very, very turmoiled. And I, you know, it sounds very grave to say that, but I'm very curious on what was going on with Yoda at the time.
Yeah. And I take it that this is the framing device. His time on Dagobah is what's causing him to think about these other stories. And considering that each one of the story arcs is three issues, I'm guessing issue 10 will have the most involvement of him there on Dagobah, coming to whatever conclusion he comes to before Luke shows up, or maybe as Luke shows up. So it'll be interesting to get some things from his perspective in that mm-hmm. regard. So we were just singing the virtues and glory of Charles Soule a moment ago, and he is about to write his 100th issue of a Star Wars comic when Star Wars number 25 gets released. Woo-hoo. And that's 100 issues of goodness as far as I'm concerned. And to celebrate that, he's going to be teaming up with all of his artists from his runs on Darth Vader, the Poe Dameron comic, the Obi-Wan and Anakin miniseries, and the Rise of Kylo Ren. So that should be epic. I may have to get a physical copy of that one. I primarily read my comics digitally now, but that might be a fun one to have.
Oh, yeah, for sure. Because, I mean, that's just not something that is just your run-of-the-mill kind of issues going out there. Yeah, this is very substantial.
Mm-hmm. And then Star Wars Hyperspace Stories launches this fall, and this is coming from Dark Horse. It's being written by Amanda Dibert, Cecil Castellucci, and Michael Morikai. I'm not familiar with all their work, but this is kind of the replacement for Star Wars Adventures, which is kind of the all-ages comics that IDW was being put out there. One of the things that they're teasing there is that this is a story that's going to be spanning different ages, but there is going to be a character with some sort of an item that runs through all of them. And if you're paying enough attention, you'll get like a full story about that character. And the only thing I could think of was, is that if you watched Friends back in the day in the coffee shop, there was like characters in the background that had some sort of ongoing thing. And I think they did that also in How I Met Your Mother as well. And so if you're paying attention, you could see these characters that would show up time after time and had like a developing relationship or something. So I'm curious what that is. It is intriguing, and I don't know if it's going to be as subtle as what I just suggested or if it's going to be a little bit more prominent than that.
Interesting. It's almost gives me From a Certain Point of View kind of vibes as well. Mm-hmm. You know, sort of, you know, you're getting this item, and then as you put in our notes here, it's a story within a story about a character and an item. Yep. Very intriguing, not gonna lie.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And then also coming from Dark Horse is Kevin Scott, again, another prolific Star Wars writer. Next comic series, and it's called Tales from the Rancor Pit. And this seems to be the successor from Tales from Vader's Castle. It'll be arriving this Halloween and will give us more spooky Halloween-inspired stories set in the Star Wars universe. And you can expect Baby Wampas, Droid Ghosts, Ty York, and more. So we're going to be getting a few more High Republic tie-ins there.
Fun. And I know what we're going to be doing for Halloween this year.
Yeah, we always try and find something, and now we got it. So
thank you, Star Wars and Kevin Scott.
Yep, can't wait to get to that one. And then we alluded to this in our last news episode, but Star Wars Visions is going to continue in comic book form. Hmm. So the way that this was talked about is that the anime studios have other stories that they want to tell, but they're not going to be turning them into anime. We're going to be getting them as comics.
Oh, that is an interesting way to go.
Yeah, impressive. I think it... You know, I may sound like I'm contradicting myself by saying this, because I've always said I'm not a big anime fan. I'm happy to have them as comics, but I think I would have just as soon got them as anime again, because that was just a fresh take on Star Wars, and I didn't love all those stories, but I liked a lot of them quite a bit. And I think I would like to have seen some of those stories continued, but it sounds like this is going to be all new stuff. But, you know, what do you think?
Well, is this going to be in the same vein as what we talked about with the different cultures lending their animation styles to it as well, such as, you know, India and all of these other places? So if that's the case, I mean, that's pretty exciting to get to see some of these things spring to life from a comic book aspect.
Yeah, my impression was is this is the Japanese studios that were doing the anime, and this is not going to be the worldwide version, whereas season two of Visions is going to be video from all those studios that we talked about. So
okay.
Yeah,
well, it's interesting then that I'm sorry that they're going with a comic book adaptation instead of a manga.
And it may be, as far as I know, but we don't have a ton of detail on that. A manga would make more sense.
Right, that's what I'm saying.
Right. Mm-hmm. Yeah, but I don't know. It I'm sure it's something I'll pick up and I'll read and it should be interesting, but I'm just thinking, you know, La Pinocho and just the various stories there that begged for a follow-up there. And I guess they could do it in a comic, but it's not certain that they're going to continue those stories, whether they're doing it in an anime or manga or this comic. That this may be new stuff, and I guess there's plenty of other stories to tell, but there's a lot of those characters I just like to revisit from that first season.
I agree. Mm-hmm. And you mentioned La Pinocho, and you took the words right out of my brain pan because I was thinking the exact same thing.
Mm-hmm. All right. So that's it for comics. We've got some video game news, and I know you're going to be excited about this first one, but we got the trailer for Jedi Fallen Order's sequel, and this has got also a formal title, and Star Wars Jedi Survivor. Some of the highlights from the trailer include some stormtroopers marching while they're holding a case. We see someone floating in Bacta from various angles throughout this trailer. The ship, whose name is escaping me from the first game, appears to have crashed. We get a scene of Cal Kestis fighting someone who is wielding a red lightsaber. And then there is some sort of a Pawan sitting at a table in an office. And the voiceover says, "Why lead when they won't follow? Why fight when you can't win? What is your next move, Cal Kestis?" And then he opens the case to see Cal's lightsaber sitting in there. And then the trailer concludes with Cal looking at this person floating in Bacta. I got the impression, Jay, it was a woman, but I couldn't tell if it was someone we were supposed to know or someone new. But what did you think about all this?
Oh, I have been chomping at the bit to talk about this. You know, I have. I've watched this trailer probably 15 times, honestly. And I've tried to dissect who that is floating in that Bacta. And I'm not sure if it's male or female. Whoever it is very, very buff because the long hair throws me off completely. But it looks like their arm is missing from just below the shoulder. So just above the bicep on the one side. And so, of course, there's all kinds of things that we could speculate in terms of, you know, who this person might be. And it was the Mantis, by the way, is the name of the ship. You're welcome. But I'm so excited for this because, I mean, just the title itself, Jedi Survivor, I mean, that's telling you who's in this. It's got to be the person in the tank. Mm-hmm. And so I'm so super stoked about this one. I cannot wait for this to come out.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to it as well. I probably should get on a replay of Fallen Order because it's been forever since I've touched that game. And I think I've said this before, I watched both my boys complete it, so I kind of didn't have the drive to finish it myself. I got through most of the game, but then other things came up, and it's a good game. It's a lot of fun, and I enjoyed it quite a bit. So I'll need to do that before this one comes out. I feel like I have plenty of time, but I say that, and then I'll continue to feel like I have plenty of time, and I'll just never get around to it. So it's
such is life.
Yeah. But
I know that feeling.
I'll have to put aside a few hours to do that. All right. Well, the last story we have is that you can start meeting some new characters in Galaxy's Edge. On May 28th, Boba Fett and Fennec Shand were starting to patrol that area. Well, Jay, you and I got to meet them there in Galaxy's Edge. Or at least I didn't meet Boba Fett. I saw Fennec wandering around quite a bit. Boba wasn't out and about yet. What's notable about this is that they're kind of breaking the continuity a little bit by having them show up when they do, because Galaxy's Edge is supposed to take place between The Last Jedi and The Rise of Skywalker. I think they learned a lesson from Marvel's Avengers Campus, which is in Disney California's Adventure, and that they don't have it restricted to any particular time period, so any Marvel character can show up there. The likes of Boba Fett and Fennec Shand are pretty popular, and people would want to meet them, so mm-hmm. makes perfect sense.
Oh, I agree. And, you know, the thing about it is that even though this particular area of Disney and at Galaxy's Edge, like you said, is supposed to encompass a particular timeline, realistically, for the fans that are there, it's timeless. It's immersive. It's the Star Wars universe, essentially, you know, at your fingertips in being able to experience just a slice of the galaxy. And so why not explore different timelines? And I did get to see Boba. Very cool. He was actually interacting with a lot of people. He was extremely popular. And you mentioned Fennec, and that was just amazing to see her there and giving her glares at everyone. And, you know, I had said, oh, gosh, how wonderful that would that be if you're having a crappy morning? You can just take it to work and no one cares. That's what they expect. Mm-hmm. So I think that's awesome.
Right. And then at some point, Din Djarin, the Mandalorian, and Grogu will start showing up there as well. So
cool.
Yeah, definitely getting away from the time period. And it's fine with me. I mean, you know, the idea was when they released Galaxy's Edge was to have you in this immersive time period and have a coherent story that ran throughout that entire area of the park. I don't feel like this breaks that so much. It would might become a problem if you've got Kylo Ren wandering around in the First Order area and then all of a sudden Han and Luke are hanging out in the Resistance area or something like that, but they're not really going with that. I mean, it would be a little weird to have Rey and young Luke in the same place, but these Disney Plus era Mando Plus verse, whatever you want to call it, characters being there, they'll fit in. And those are the characters that, like you were saying, that people are going to be looking for because they're current. And mm-hmm. so that makes sense. And why not? So,
right. Yeah, I assume that they would probably at some point even perhaps add Ahsoka or Bo-Katan or, you know, who knows?
They certainly could. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Hera.
Sabine. So all those characters from the upcoming series, you know, maybe the kids and Jude Law's character from Skeld and Crew.
We'll have to see. Yeah.
All right. Okay. Well, it didn't take us nearly as long to get through all the other news after we discussed Disney Plus last time. But with just like to thank everyone for listening to another episode of Podcast Stardust and our second or part two of our discussion of the reveals from Star Wars Celebration. We hope you enjoyed all this. And if you did, please make sure to subscribe to Podcast Stardust on your podcatcher of choice. I'd like to remind you that you can find all episodes of the podcast over on RetroZap.com, which is also home to several other great podcasts covering everything from the MCU and DC to Dune and Star Trek. As always, we greatly appreciate 5-star ratings and reviews on whatever podcatcher it is that you use, especially Apple Podcasts. And please share the show and your favorite episodes on social media with your friends. Speaking of which, Jay, what are our social media contacts one more time?
All right, Dennis, we can be found on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram at Podcast Stardust. And just to springboard too off of what you said, I have people all the time asking where can they stream our shows? And we are literally everywhere. And, you know, as Dennis mentioned, we can be found on all of your major streaming platforms. We're also on Spotify, Audible, Google Podcasts, you name it, and we are actually there. So again, at Podcast Artist, and you can find us. And we also have a Pinterest board and a YouTube channel, which does have all of our episodes as well as unboxing videos. And for some real-time chatter, you can always catch us over on our Discord room on the RetroZap Discord server, where we are one of just many, many different rooms over there. All the RetroZap shows have their own room, and there's a lot of other dedicated rooms to some different things as well. So you just have to go over and explore it. And if you want to do that, you can go to our show page, click on our community tab, and you are there. And if you'd like to support us by picking up some Podcast Artist swag, we have 7 different show logo designs available over on our TeePublic store. And we are teepublic.com/user/podcaststardust. And you can pick up everything from apparel to home goods, even refrigerator magnets, baby onesies, and everything in between. And just be looking out for sales because they always seem to be having something good going on over there. And speaking of something good going on, Dennis, why don't you let everybody know what you've got going on with Warp Trails?
Sure. So my wife, Beth, and I are talking about Star Trek on Warp Trails, and that covers all the new series that have been coming out on Paramount Plus, which includes Discovery, Picard, Lower Decks, and Strange New Worlds. We put those out as we can. So sometimes you'll get two or three in a week, and then sometimes there'll be a little bit of a break. It's just trying to navigate our schedules. The show is exclusive to the Retro Zap podcast feed, which you can find on your podcatcher of choice. So if you're into the Star Trek shows, come hang out with Beth and I as we get into those. So, Jay, I know you've been keeping busy as usual with cosplay. So what is the latest there?
All right. Well, over on my Instagram, which is at j.snipscosplay, you can catch me all the time over there, either as Ahsoka or Hera, and maybe some new things this summer as well. Colby Wan and I have a couple things in the works. One is Fifth Brother and Fourth Sister. And then we've also got some Hera and Jason things on the table as well. So don't want to give out too much about that, but you'll just have to check out that Instagram to find out. And if you'd like to follow Colby Wan, he is at Nihilus Knows Cosplay. So that's Nihilus as in Darth Nihilus. N-O-S-E, all one word. And with that, we're just having a heck of a lot of fun, and hope you'll come out and join us for that.
All right, that'll do it for this episode of Podcast Stardust. Thanks for listening, and until next time, may the Force be with you.